when you have a lot of money, like in a big studio film, you can get complacent with what you're making, and if you have a lot of money, it becomes about the money. But Kip and Kern are in this to make a movie, you know, and to tell a story. And I had a conversation a couple days ago with Kern, and he had this idea where Liam runs on the corner of, I believe it's Sunset and La Cienega, and runs down this hill, and you open up to show, you know, all of Los Angeles. And he was saying, I've wanted to do that for the last like three or four films I've made. I just couldn't figure out where to put it in, and I finally got to do it. And I heard a little bird told me that he actually teared up when he finally made it. Are you catching
me? It's sort of based on a real story of you know, for, you know, the co-director, David Wren. And I think it rings true. You know, you have to go through something like this in order for the material to come across as, wow, this really seems like someone went through this.
Fuck Sugar Sally, fuck her up, her sugary ass. You're dumping me for some Chinese girl?
Shh, we were never really together.
Oh, right, I forgot, I'm only 16.
From the beginning, I've referenced myself because I don't really know David. And it was easy. It wasn't hard to, because I felt like I went through a lot of parallel experiences. I.e., I went to China last November to visit my father's village in China with my grandmother. Kind of, it wasn't really planned. It was just kind of, one Thanksgiving, my grandmother said, hey, if I ever go to China, will you come with me? And I said, yes. And then she had an operation. And then when she came out of it, wanted to go back home and said, I'm going. You coming? And I said, sure, I had time. And a couple of months later, the script came up. So there was a weird feeling of rightness that it felt right, you know?
Don't move here just for me.
Do you want to see me again?
Of course.
Would you miss me if I left?
Would you miss me?
You are the most amazing girl I've ever met.
I think Mickey and Adelaide are two opposite ends of the pendulum. And Liam is not really quite sure of which way he wants to go. You know, I think there's a part of him that absolutely adores Adelaide, simply because she is adorable, and you know, he can really sort of relate to her mentally, and yet there's something about Mickey that sort of, I think, fills that void. Of his loss of Chinese heritage. I think she really sort of brings him back to being Chinese and taking pride in who he is and his ethnicity and culture.
You're right. I spend my entire life running away from anything Chinese, including my father. But I come here I feel like I belong here.
And so they're two completely opposite women, and the choice to between the two would be, you know, so difficult to make, really. I mean, if they were one woman, they'd be perfect, wouldn't they? But there's just one body too many.
Adelaide is probably one of the funnest characters I've ever played. She's fun, outgoing. She's one of a kind. She's one of a kind person. She's the kind of person that you sort of meet and they kind of freak you out a little bit, like, okay, this person is a total weirdo because of their energy. But then you sort of, they interest you and they pull you in and you make you want to find out more about them.
What's wrong?
Nothing.
What's wrong? Come on.
I have to go to Shanghai in a week.
Why are you going to Shanghai, silly rabbit?
My grandmother died.
I'm sorry.
And I never met her or anything, but she left her house to me.
My boyfriend has a house in Shanghai. That's really cool.
Can you please not call me your boyfriend?
Liam is 12 years older than Adelaide is, so there's a little bit of a conflict there. Just a little bit. And, you know, they've got such a far distance apart in age that it's sort of... It's hard for Liam's character to accept it, to accept the fact that he loves her because of that. When Adelaide is the one who's more mature, really, and who's living life and who's having fun and who's very bright and you know, who's mature enough to accept the fact that he's that much older than her, and she can keep up with him. She can carry on a conversation. She's on the same level as him emotionally. So, you know, he just sort of has to wise up.
Listen, Joe.
Yeah.
I need you to do something for me while I'm in Shanghai.
What? Want to renew your subscription to Barely Legal?
It's Addie.
Oh, enough with Addie. Come on. I'm going to lay out a general rule here, okay? In America, if you hook up with a 16-year-old girl, you go to prison for roughly 20 years. And I'm not talking about Culver City.
This is not about that. It's not about hooking up.
Look, you're the cool older guy right now. But in 10 years, you're just gonna be the old guy.
Just take her to school in the mornings. That's it. And make sure
Liam,
that...
Liam, she has parents. She's not little orphan Annie. What do you want me to do? Give her some clam chowder and send her to bed? Shit. She was doing just fine before you got there. Joe's interesting because Joe is sort of Liam's reality check throughout the whole film. It's kind of the audience's view of where Liam in the story that we're telling. And it's great. It's a great relationship because Ken, the wonderful actor that he is, and I were really able to play off of each other for the whole process. And we got together and rehearsed, and we're just able to feel each other out and where we wanted to go with it, and sat down with Kip and Kern and David, the writer, and just sort of developed these characters and figured out where we were coming from and how much we wanted to invest into the emotional status of each other and the arc of our characters and where we were going to take it, because we wanted to be able to tell the story and as well as maintaining the friendship that we have. So there's times that you'll see us try to check each other, kind of give each other a gut check, but not go too far because we're still men and we still don't want to do too much. We don't want to act like we care. But it was great. It was great. We were able to just kind of throw in gags and bits and improv a lot and be able to develop these characters as we went.
We're still in the kind of thick of it now, you know, we're still shooting and everything. But when it's over, I know that I'm gonna sit with it for a while and kind of think about what happened and stuff. I think the lesson will be more clear then. But I feel like it's probably right, not for the reasons that I thought. Which in itself is a kind of nice thing.